Hey guys, so I'm gonna try and answer your questions now from that question and answers video that you guys left all your comments on Instagram and on YouTube. I am so thankful for you guys. Man, you blew me away on how many questions you asked. It took forever to go through them all and try and keep from, you know, doubling questions and answers. So I think I did pretty good, but I'm sorry if I repeat myself a little bit. And thank you for all the love that you guys show me and Colt. You are literally like a really great group of people. Our subscribers and followers are just so amazing. So thank you so much for being part of everything and, you know, just sharing this life with us. It's been an adventure, and having you guys along for the ride is just even better. You guys are so supportive at every turn, and I'm thankful for you. So this is gonna be a part one out of two videos. I'm gonna do the YouTube questions first in part one and the Instagram questions in the part two video. So they may be a few days apart. It's already taken me a while to get all of these in order and hopefully not in doubles and everything. So just bear with me. But I hope these questions help you. Whoever asked the question first, I'm answering it that way. So it's not that I'm trying to ignore you. If you had asked a couple of questions and one of them was already answered previously in the video, I will most likely not be answering double questions again. I tried to cut that all out. So I hope you enjoy this video and keep a watch for part two, and there will be many other questions on there. Again, thank you guys so much for your questions. So the first question is, who is Garrett? Garrett is my fiance, and legally considered my husband as well. It's not like we don't plan to get married. We just haven't gotten around to it. We want to have a nice big wedding, so, you know, it's something worth waiting for. But we already consider ourselves to be married, already. So yeah, that's who Garrett is. I've been with him since a few months before my accident happened in 2012, and he is just an amazing guy. I mean, went from us being two normal people together and all of a sudden him being a caretaker and, me having a disability. And so then he was, you know, carrying me from the bed to the bathroom, to go to the bathroom, helping bathe me and stuff like that. So he is an amazing man, and I am so grateful for him. He works like 60 to 70 hour weeks, so you don't see him very often. He, you know, to provide for our family, he is such a hardworking man, and I love him so much. But that's who Garrett is. Who are your cats and ferret? I have two cats. I have, I wonder if he's behind me. Yes, right behind me is Panther, who is a Maine Coon mix. He is a big kitty, like a very big kitty. And you could probably tell him compared to Nova, if you've seen any pictures or videos of them, you'll notice that he's a big boy. And Nova is right there laying next to Colt right now. She's a Balinese, which is a long hair Siamese. And then my ferret's name is Bear. And I'm pretty sure you guys, you know, may have already heard he's having some pretty significant health issues right now. And he's probably going to pass here within, you know, days. We're not sure. But he's been fighting like crazy, more than my vet thought, and the meds have been helping him a lot, so we're trying to fight for him as much as he's fighting, so we'll see what happens with that. But I love him. He's he's older, so it's not like he's, you know, super young and that he didn't really have a life or anything. Why did you choose the name Colt? So the name Colt came from firearms and horses. I have ridden and loved horses my entire life. A male baby horse's name is a colt. So since he had such long legs, looked like he was going to be a giant, and you know, a little tiny wobbly puppy, I thought Colt was perfect because I love horses. He was going to be a horse, basically. And we also love shooting and love firearms. So Colt 45 was our first weapon together, me and Garrett. So it kind of just fit. Colt was like perfect all around. Kind of a short and sweet name. It fit his personality and we love it. Did you train Colt by yourself or did he get trained by a trainer? What age is Colt? Does Colt get excited by some things? I trained Colt 100% by myself. If anything came up that I wasn't able to handle or I wasn't like helping him with training or whatever, I would contact a trainer. I'm totally open to that. But I was able to do everything by myself. I do have experience training military canines and police canines. So I was able to have the experience to be able to train him, and I'm thankful for that. But I don't have any problems with contacting any trainer. And majority of people that own or train a service dog do have a trainer alongside them training the entire time. Most people do not have the experience that they need to successfully train a service dog. Colt is right now almost five. He'll be five on May 15th, I think. I totally could be wrong right now. My memory's really bad. And does he get excited by some things? Yeah. I mean, he's still a dog. I'm not sure the context of your question. Things excite him all the time. He loves watching squirrels outside. I was wondering if he was gonna go look out the door. And he loves other animals and plays with them and has fun and gets excited to see my family and my friends and stuff like that. But when he's working, you know, he's working. So he like knows the distinction between, there are the occasional times when he's working and will like run into a friend just randomly out somewhere and I haven't seen him in, you know, like a year or something, and he'll get a little bit excited where I'll tell him to lay down and he'll whine or something and protest, but he still knows like he's working and stuff. So he's not, he knows the difference between work and play, but when he's off duty and there is someone here that's a friend or family or, you know, a little creature that he wants to play with, he definitely shows it. He has a very crazy excitement level over sticks and toys and balls and stuff. He has a high drive. So I hope that answers your question. What is Colt's favorite thing to do and what was the hardest task to train? Colt, his favorite thing to do, I would think, is swim. He loves swimming. So even in the winter, he would want to swim. I actually have to keep him away from the water because he would. And there's the occasional time that I will let him, because it's not like we have like an Arctic winter or anything, where he'll be cold. But you know, as long as I give him a warm bath after, he's fine. But yeah, swimming is his number one favorite thing. The hardest task to train, I would think the hardest task to train him, and it's not necessarily a task, wait, it's a task, but it's, the part that I was training was just, like, shaping his already natural alert for seizures, that was not easy because his natural alert was like a total panic. He was unhappy, barking, jumping on me, trying to tell me something was wrong. And I just thought he was like, had a screw loose or something, because we had got him to start training him. He was doing amazing. And he was probably like 5 or 6 months old. My memory's really bad, but around there somewhere that he started alerting naturally. But it was so far in advance that like, we had no idea that that's what he was doing for like a good 2 months. And we were already pretty much having a home picked out for him because with my, you know, extensive issues, especially during that time, him jumping on me, he was already pretty big at that point, jumping on me, knocking me over and stuff could, you know, cause a serious issue. So we were scared and, we were about to get rid of him and thinking that he was just going to be a washout, that he was going to work out as a service dog. And then we realized what he was doing. It took a while, but we finally put two and two together, and I'm so thankful that we didn't give him up because he was doing his job, basically. I mean, we originally got him for other things. He was going to be a basic assistant service dog, and seizure response. So we didn't know that he was even going to be capable of doing the alert to a seizure. So shaping that was very hard. We still have training over and over again to keep him from reverting back to that. I personally think that a service dog should never be barking in public, unless for very rare circumstances, because it's disruptive no matter what the dog is doing. It still could be construed as, you know, disruptive and aggressive. Somebody might be scared of the dog or something if it was barking. So no matter what task it may have been trained to do, majority of the time you can train it to not bark. So there's been times that I've had to, you know, go back and train with him again. Not that he's reverted all the way back to barking at me or jumping on me or anything, but there's been times where he's, you know, starts getting a little more upset than realizing that he's, you know, he just needs to be calm, let me know, and then everything's fine. So it was really hard to shape and keep his appropriate behavior and alerting instead of him, like, going a little batshit crazy. And he's never gone all the way back to that, but I don't want him ever to start reverting back and continue reverting all the way back to that inappropriate behavior. But I would say that was the hardest thing. How long have you had Colt? Also, are you working on any new tasks for him to do? I've had Colt since he was 8 weeks old. I think he was almost 9 weeks old. New tasks. You know, with my health things changing or whatever, I add things on here and there. Like when I ended up back in a wheelchair, I was in a wheelchair before I got Colt. When I ended up back in a wheelchair after another brain injury causing more brain damage and I needed a little more help, I had to train him stuff like that. Retrieving my wheelchair, pulling my wheelchair and wheelchair awareness and all that kind of stuff. So stuff gets added on quite frequently with like a progressive illness, disability. You know, I've been having really bad low blood sugar lately. I've always had hypoglycemia, and I just recently it's been so bad that I don't know if I should try and work on training him, you know, low blood sugar alerts. He's never really done, like, if I get to the point where I'm about to pass out, he's told me that before, like, get down, but he doesn't necessarily come up and let me know that my blood sugar's low. So I think it's just like his normal alerts, like he does with passing out, where he alerts to that. So that may be something that I think of training if my blood sugar keeps doing what it's doing. But it is also very hard for me to train that with him just because my blood sugar can drop and spike after a seizure. And it's super common because you're basically doing a really hardcore workout. And the blood sugar dropping like that, I just don't know, like, I don't know. I don't want him to get, like, alerts mixed up between the seizure and the blood sugar and, like, so I don't know. That will be something that I think about more and more, especially if I continue having drops this low. What is my favorite breed of dog? What was your funniest, weirdest experience with the public? What's your dream breed for your next service dog? And what is your favorite task and favorite trick of Colts? What's your favorite thing to train? That's a mouthful for sure. Favorite breed of dogs, I would say German Shepherds. They're just my heart dog. And, you know, with a service dog, you can't really pick and choose what breed. You know, even if it's your favorite breed, the dog may not be able to do the job at hand. And in my case, a German Shepherd would most likely not fit the standards that I need for mobility. And sometimes German Shepherds can start developing issues from a handler's, say like a psychiatric side of a handler's issues. So I don't necessarily have any psychiatric disabilities, but because of my brain injury, I do portray some of those things. So I've had depression, and I've had, I guess that's the wrong thing to say because I have been diagnosed with depression. But like mood swings and bipolar type stuff, I have experienced as well, but it is from my brain injury. I'm not diagnosed bipolar, and I'm not diagnosed, you know, multiple personalities and stuff like that. So I may not need a psychiatric service dog, but some of the things that I deal with in my life do mimic some of the psychiatric illnesses out there. So with a German Shepherd dog, they're known to feed off of that and sometimes develop those own issues themselves or develop protective, which a lot of German Shepherds are protective naturally. And if you're having an anxiety attack or something like that, they may think of that as you're in danger or you're scared or whatever and that they need to protect you. So even though I love German Shepherd dogs, I most likely would never find the perfect dog easily from that breed. So for service dog work, you can't always just pick what you feel like you want. It doesn't really work that way. The dog needs to be able to do the job and do it right. The funniest and weirdest experience with the public, I think I'll put those in two different categories because weirdest was not funny at all, but I've had funny moments. Some of the funny moments I think are when people see me brace on Colt and get up out of my wheelchair, or when they walk up and wave their hand in front of your face asking if you're blind. So those to me are pretty funny. I can see how they're funny because I understand people are so uneducated. But I mean, it can be very like rude for sure. The weirdest I would say was we were in Walmart and a guy came up and told me that if I wasn't blind, Colt wasn't a service dog. And he successfully took the leash from my hands. And this was at the time that I was using a leash before my latest brain injuries when I could safely use one. And he started pulling Colt towards the front door. Like, he, as a person that was shopping there, could make the decision to, one, take my dog, and two, take him outside. Like, he had some kind of authority. It was pretty weird and scary. I tried to fight with him to grab him, my dog, back, and it caused me to fall on the ground. And the guy kept trying to pull Colt towards the door, and Colt was like skidding, kind of like, you know, he wanted to stay with me, so he was like skidding, and the guy was just pulling him against his will out, trying to go out the door. And so many people were watching this happen and didn't even do anything. And then finally someone came and grabbed Colt's leash from the guy and told him that he wasn't allowed to do that. And with all everything going on, I lost track of the guy. But the police came and they looked at the cameras and everything, and nothing really came of it. So that was crazy. I guess the guy left. But that was the weirdest thing I think has ever happened, that somebody felt the need to judge me based off of that I didn't look physically disabled at that moment, and that he could take Colt away from me. So that was very strange. My dream breed for my next service dog, I actually try not to think about that too much. I mean, obviously it crosses my mind and I kind of think about certain things, but I'm not making any definitive decisions and focusing on that right now. Colt has many years left of working, and honestly, it's something super stressful to think about. You know, is the dog going to naturally alert? What's my life going to be like if the dog can't naturally alert? Do I keep trying with dogs until I find one that can naturally alert? So it's stressful. I don't even want to think about it. So honestly, I don't think about it. What is your favorite task and favorite trick of Colt's? I would say his favorite task, even though it wasn't trained, it was shaped, is his seizure alert and pass out alert. He has saved my ass, I don't know if I'm allowed to say that, many, many times, like so many times. And I mean, I've hit my head a lot and stuff even since having him, but with how many medical issues I have in a day, it is a tiny, 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 tiny percentage of how many times I would have fallen, you know, without him. So I've, yes, cracked my head open, hit my head since having him, but it is like 1 in 1,000 that I get hurt. And it's, I'm so thankful for that. And I mean, it's like living in fear all the time of, am I going to pass out today? Am I going to hit my face? Am I going to break my nose again? Am I going to need my, you know, jaw wired shut? Am I gonna break my teeth again? Am I, you know, so it's scary. I mean, I've broken my ribs, I've broken my wrist, I've broken my fingers, I've broken my nose, I've cracked my orbital socket, I've obviously had brain bleeds and stuff from falling. It's scary. And so with me having, you know, multiple pass outs a day, and multiple seizures a day, and sometimes many, many seizures a day, only getting hurt every once in a while is really not that big of a deal. I mean, I don't know if I said that right. Like, he does his job amazing, and I'm thankful for it. Obviously, 100% of the time, it's not going to be perfect where, you know, he's not going to get grabbed and distracted by somebody, and that I, you know, he doesn't do his second. Okay, get up. I was watching him to see if he was alerting, but he's actually requesting to get on the couch because he actually has to ask to get up there. I don't know where I was at. Oh, his favorite trick is, I would think, are you comfortable now? I would think his favorite trick, for him to do would be, sneeze. I know that sounds really dumb, but yes, I taught my dog how to sneeze on command, and it is so annoying now that I realize, after I taught him, because that's like his go-to. He will sneeze a ton of times while I'm telling him to do something, if I'm trying to teach him something new. Sometimes he'll just offer a sneeze and think that it's done and good, that's what I wanted, and he can stop now. It's hilarious. Like, I don't even know how to explain it. It's hilarious. I'll try and catch it on camera one of these days. My favorite trick to do with him, I would say, is probably bounding off trees. I mean, he enjoys it a lot too, but I think, or a wall, bounding off of any object, it really works his muscles good, and like agility wise, and since he's his growth plates are closed and stuff, it doesn't cause him harm, but it's something that really strengthens his muscles in a way that I haven't seen in anything else for mobility work. He's very strong, muscular-wise. What's your favorite thing to train? I don't know. I love training in general. I wish I could do it for other people, train dogs for veterans or something like that. But because of my disability, it's hard enough for me to train Colt and then keep up with his training. And then thinking about getting a prospect, which is super stressful. Don't even want to go there. Starting all over again. Oh my gosh. I don't know. That's just so much stress. But yeah, training in general is a very big, wonderful thing for me in my life. Kind of, you know, gives you like kind of like a control, not necessarily that, you know, the dog's going to be perfect, but it is with so much in your life that you can't really control. I feel like, you know, being able to control the fact that you can teach your dog to completely ignore other dogs that are like, you know, lifting up his rear end while he's trying to smell his butt or something. And having a dog at that level, and everything makes you feel like you can at least control something in your life, and you know, give your dog like a better life, because the dog is not stressed out and anxious about stuff. It, you know, knows what to do, and it's been acclimated to that. And so I think just training in general is my favorite thing. What training techniques do you use? Let me take a drink before I answer that one. So most of my life I've tried different training techniques with dogs. I started off training, you know, a ton of different dogs. I trained pet dogs, I trained military canines and police canines and stuff, and there's many different forms that you need to use. But I found with Colt as a service dog, starting Colt off in training, I only used what I felt was best for him. I did it with praise and, you know, positive respect back to the dog. The reason I went that route with Colt, even though he has a very high ball drive, very food motivated, not, I wouldn't say to the extreme, but he's pretty food motivated. I felt like he, as a service dog, needed to have a very good mutual respect between me and him, and not expect a treat every time he did something. Not that I didn't want to give him treats or let him play with the ball or anything. I just wanted to start off his training with every time he learns something new, whether it's a new command or a new task, it's always started with praise only, high praise, and letting him know, that's what I wanted, that's a great behavior, thank you so much, that's a good dog, and mutual respect between us. And when he has already learned something the first time, that is at the point where, when we're redoing the training on that, just another training session, he's probably not even close to having it down pat, that's when I will give him treats. So the first go around until he knows it is only praise. And then when he does already know it, maybe he just needs refreshing, maybe he needs it shaped a little bit better so that he's doing it faster, or you know, not doing it a certain way or something like that, that is when I'll use treats. So I kind of make it fun again with treats. But this way, when I do ask him to do it, he's not expecting a treat, or you don't have a treat, and so he's like, eh, I'm gonna take my time, or not gonna really care. So he still has that like drive to please, not just to get a treat. So that has been a big thing that I think has made him such an amazing service dog. And you know, I still give him tons and tons of treats. If you guys follow us, you know how many treats he gets, and I love him and I spoil him, and he has toys that cost $30. So I love him. That's just the way that I chose to go. And moving on to some more questions. Where did I get Colt? How old was Colt when you got him, and what breed is Colt? I did think I already asked the how old he was when I got him, about 8 weeks, maybe a little bit older. Where did you get Colt? I got him from a rescue, but from a breeder. So that's a little bit of a long story. Something happened to the breeder or his wife or something like that. I got relayed the information, so I'm, you know, I may be forgetting, or may not have had the full story, but something tragic happened. They gave up all their breeding dogs, males and females, and multiple litters at the time. There was a few really young ones, few just about the age ready to go home, and a few that were a little bit older that hadn't gone to homes yet. And they were Weimaraner labs that were being bred for generations. So it wasn't just, you know, a Weim mom and a lab dad. They were already mixed Weim labs. He had bred for, you know, the great aspects of both breed to make a very good working line dog. He also bred them to be, you know, a larger size. So they were all pretty large. So they ended up at this rescue that was a Weimaraner rescue. I do love Weimaraners, so I had gone there and let them know what I was looking for, that it needed to be a puppy that had health certificates for it. I couldn't just rescue any Weimaraner. And they gave me a call and said, so it's not a Weimaraner, but it's a Weimaraner lab. We have a ton of them for you to come look at if you want to. So I called up the behavioralist that I had already talked with and chosen and had seen multiple puppies with at the time. And so I called her up, set up a time. We went down there and we did it a couple times, and the testing went great on almost all the dogs. But some of them are just a little bit higher in testing than others. And I ended up picking Colt, who had already seemed to have a connection with me. And he was a very large puppy, so it looked like it was gonna work out great for mobility. And that's how I got him. Are you looking into getting a prospect? If yes, when and which breed? Did you use only treats for his training or other training tools? I did already talk about the prospect thing. I don't really want to think about it right now. I did use treats, but I used it after I'd already taught him something. Other training tools, I have used a vibration collar, I've used a halter, a chain, You know, I think that's it. The vibration collar I used when I was shaping his alert, it was, basically, he's a touch dog. Sometimes he's a hard-headed dog and he's very overdriven. So sometimes you gotta just like poke him like to get his attention. And it's not that I'm trying to hurt him, and it's all proven to be safe for dogs. It's not a shock collar, it's vibration and sound. And it helped very much to get him snapped out of that like crazy psycho area that he would go in his brain when he was thinking I was gonna have a seizure and, you know, the worst thing in the world was gonna happen. Once he realized everything was gonna be okay and we shaped it and I got his attention with that, everything was fine. I do use it occasionally to continue keeping him, like I said, in that good alerting behavior and not letting him revert back. I have put it on as just a reminder in a just in case where, you know, I've noticed him starting to get a little more, persistent and kind of frantic about it. And so I realized, you know, I gotta do that to have it on for a day and see if I can catch him in that moment to try and help bring him back into what he's supposed to be doing. Most of the time I don't need to. Most of the time he, you know, kind of goes back into it and I gently remind him and he's fine. So it's something, it's more of just a precaution, but in the early years, it was something that was more needed. I am not able to use a leash physically, because it could harm me during a seizure. My right side is numb, so yes, I can use it, but I have no control of strength to be able to grab the dog anyway with the leash, and his, task could be interfered with as well. If he's trying to get help and he was tethered to me or something like that, it could just be a huge disaster. So he's been specifically trained after a certain point in my health decline to be off leash only. So I have used a vibration collar on him occasionally to reinforce his off leash training. Just never really have had to use it, you know, but just like it's there, and I'm not strong enough to have that much control over him. He's off leash, he's very well trained, but if he is gonna be doing something as a dog, he's not a robot, I still have that backfall that I can vibrate him or beep him and let him know, like, dude, you know what you're doing, you know, it's not right. He'll be focused again. There's positive collar training. So you can look that up. That is what we have done with him every once in a while. It's not a common thing. It's just something that is part of his training. A head halty was the start of his off-leash training, just to get him to focus more. It helped with, directing his focus onto me sometimes if he wasn't, and it was a very helpful tool. We only used it for a while, but there's the occasional time that we will pull it back out if it needs to be. How do you know you wanted to get a Wine Lab mix? How did you pick out Colt and who helped you choose him? What is Colt's birthday and when did you get him? So I think I answered most of these already. I didn't want to get a Wine Lab mix. It is something that, not that I don't like them, it's just something that happened and was perfect. And sometimes with a service dog, you can't be picky. I can't just go to a Weimaraner breeder and say, I absolutely need a service dog from you. You better produce a puppy for me that will work out, and it works out. That's just not how it works. It takes multiple dogs sometimes, and I got lucky with Colt. So he's the size to do the job. He's the breed that can do the job, and he's extremely smart. And I am so glad that I found this breeder that was breeding working lines, because he is a working line. Like, he turned out amazing. His birthday, I think, is May 15th. I could be wrong about that, so hopefully I'm not, because my memory is really bad. And when did I get him? I got him in, like, 2013, something like that. It was about a year after my brain injury. How did you find that professional that helped me choose Colt? She's a dog behavioralist, so there's a lot of, you know, professional dog trainers that you can go and check out. Some of them are just not what you need for a service dog. So you have to know those questions, ask those questions. If they've trained service dogs in the past, if they've been successful, if you can get a referral from a service dog handler or a couple. And then you can also talk with, most places have behavioralists. And you can talk with them and vet them and see how well they are doing their job. And this person that was a behavioralist for me, I've already known for a while. So that was great, but still, you know, paid her. It's a professional transaction. And it's just something that you have to research in your area and look up, you know, good trainers and good behavioralists in your area. Do you think it's a bad idea to let service dogs play with other dogs? Does it lessen the bond with the dog cause your dog to be more distracted, etc.? So I do not agree with, while they're working, obviously interacting with any other dogs, whether they're service dogs or pets or, you know, your own pet or friend's pet or anything. If they're working, they're working. Obviously, when they're off duty, they can do anything they want to. Obviously, if you start seeing a issue develop, you want to work on that. But a dog should never be secluded from other dogs. I've never seen it hinder the bond. I've never seen it cause more distraction. If your dog is very dog motivated, that's something you need to work on. And it's nothing that taking them away from other dogs is really going to help. That would actually could lead to, you know, it developing into aggression instead of excitement. Does Colt have separation anxiety? If so, how do you deal with it? Colt has a little bit of separation anxiety, but not much. He definitely worries about me when he's not with me, but it's extremely rare. If I was just to walk out of the house for a second and come back, he would care less. He'd stay laying down in his bed or whatever. It's when it gets to a certain point where he's like, is she okay? Did something happen? Is my guess of what he's thinking. But he's never been, you know, barker or howler or whiner or stuff like that. I think he whimpers a little bit, but not, like, it's not excessive. And he's paced before when I was in the hospital intubated and everything. But he saw me get intubated. He saw everything that was happening. So I'm sure he was pretty stressed out by that. And that's why when I do go to the hospital and I'm not in that serious of a situation where I'm being intubated or something, and I am awake enough to be able to work on, you know, training with him, I'll do some training in the hospital to make it like a good place again, because sometimes there's really hard things that he sees, and I'm sure it's like traumatizing in a way. I mean, I'm not sure how much he understands, but if I was somebody's dog, I'd probably be traumatized if that happened in front of me. What do you say when someone is asking questions about Colt respectfully, but you just don't feel like talking? So that happens actually quite often. Most of the time when I'm filming, I'm already feeling good enough to film that I'll answer questions and stuff. But if I'm not filming, which is a lot of the times that you don't see because I'm not feeling that great, I'll, you know, just respectfully let them know I'm not really having a good day. I'm just trying to buy a gallon of milk or something. And I'll say it very nice, and, you know, there are times where I can't really say something very nice, like I'm feeling already overwhelmed or irritated or something, and I try really hard not to take it out on other people because it's not their fault. They're curious. But Garrett knows my limits and I know my limits, and we know signs for each other, and he'll come over and just let them know, and I can just walk away without saying anything. And it's not like I'm trying to be a complete ass, and I'm sure some people may find it rude still, even though we're trying so hard to be nice. Even when I respectfully educate people, there are times where people still think I'm rude, and I'm really not trying to be, but sometimes it's just the tone of the situation kind of frustrates me. I have a brain injury. It's really hard to read tone and sarcasm and you know, people's emotions and stuff. And sometimes I'm not necessarily only thinking of them. I'm dealing with that I'm going to have a seizure in a few minutes, that I may pass out in a few minutes, that my dog is trying to tell me something. And so it's hard sometimes, but I try my best to be kind at all points in life, because grace is all that you can do. Give people grace, and hopefully you'll get grace in return. Silly question, but how do you keep him cool in the summer? Boots for asphalt, lots of water. Our summers are not that hot. So, I mean, I have a cooling towel that I use for me and one for him. So if we are doing something where it is actually that hot for him, I will bring the cooling towel for him. There are cooling vests and stuff, and honestly, I've gotten them in the past and stuff, but I just don't use them enough, and they're pretty expensive. So it's really not something that I have to have, because I'll have it for years and only use it maybe once in the area that I am. The cooling towel is more frequently used because it's easy to just carry along, and the occasional time that I need it, I can put any type of water on it, whether it's hot or cold water, and it will cool down on that towel. So that's been very helpful. Lots of water, like you said, and I do put boots on him for asphalt, which is very rare where I live that it's on for the asphalt. Most of the time I use boots for when we're going shooting, there's broken glass, or, you know, he's walking across metal or something, metal grates or anything like that, where it would be hotter than asphalt, or any sharp anything, gravel, stuff like that, that he may need his boots on, escalators, all that. So for hot weather, I'm not really an expert on that. I know that there's cooling vests that you can get that are really great and helpful. Obviously, put the dog in shade. When we're running him and he's really, you know, panting and overheated because he's been running, he knows a command for shade. So that was kind of a strange thing that I had to teach him, but there's not always the time where I can grab him and drag him over the shade, especially if I'm in my wheelchair or something and I can't get up, you know, onto the grass in it, up the curb or whatever. I just need to be able to like point and say, go to the shade, and he knows what I mean, and he'll go and lay down. I carry water for me and I carry water for him. Are there ways that Colt holds you back, restricts what you can do? I would say that how my life would be without him would be 100 times worse. So I don't see him as restricting anything. I see him as giving me life, because I would be wearing a helmet every day of my life. You know, never be able to have my hair up in a nice bun or anything like that. I'd be in a helmet all the time. I would have everything in my house, all the corners blocked off, and I wouldn't be able to go out, let alone alone. I don't very much go out alone, but I wouldn't be able to at all. So it's definitely more of a blessing than restricting me in any way. I mean, there's of course things that you have to, you know, find ways around, like if you wanted to go to amusement park or something, you know, maybe have someone hold the dog for you, someone in your party, not some random person, hold the dog for you while you took a turn and came back And that's honestly if your health will allow that. And obviously your dog would have to be trained for that. So, how would you go swimming in an indoor pool with a service dog? Is it okay to leave them unattended on the pool deck? Could Colt still alert you when you're in the water? So personally with me, Colt goes every time I'm swimming. And he lays right next to the pool. Whether it's an outdoor pool or an indoor pool, he lays right next to the edge of the pool where he would basically be able to touch the water if he put his nose down. He lays right there the entire time in a life vest. His life vest is tested for his weight and my weight combined. So he literally doesn't even have to swim when it's on because it'll keep him and me afloat the entire time. So when he needs to alert, he has that vest and he jumps in the water and pulls me out. He'll swim me out. There's many videos on his YouTube channel of that. But he's allowed to go into the water when he's alerting. There's even places that have allowed us to have him in the water just as enjoyment and even for training and stuff to get him just, you know, he already loves water, but get him comfortable with everything. People screaming and playing in the pool. And as long as everybody's okay with it and the person that owns the pool is okay with it, it's a great chance for us to train. You know, I'm from California, so there's a lot of pools in families' houses and stuff. So there's a lot of different experiences he's had with pools to be able to get his training and be 100% accurate with swimming. Every summer, before the start of the swimming season, he does get refresher training, and throughout the season, he gets refresher training because it's so dire that when I'm in the pool, if I were to have a seizure, I would probably for sure die unless someone was there. I normally have someone there with me all the time, but people aren't perfect, and people get distracted, and you know, people are not gonna just sit there and stare at me the entire time I'm swimming just because I want to swim. So that's what Colt's there for. but yeah, so I trust him with my life. I'm so thankful for Colt because I'm a swimmer. I trained for the Coast Guard for 3 years. Swimming is a huge part of my life. I had a traumatic brain injury when I was boating, tubing, like behind the boat. So obviously water's been a huge part of my life. Half my family's from California, half of them from Michigan. So lots of water in my history. So if I couldn't go swimming, I don't know what I would do with myself. How do you address bad behavior from Colt? I let him know that it's not a desired behavior. And if, you know, he continues doing it, obviously he gets like a timeout from, because obviously I don't want to get frustrated at him and, you know, teach him that I'm going to get like overly angry or anything. Just give him a timeout, tell him to go to his bed or whatever. But honestly, I haven't had such bad behavior from him, you know, since he was like a puppy. You know, and that was because he was a puppy. And so, you know, just, I use a tone that he knows, like that's not something that's desired. And so he knows, like, with mutual respect that, like, that's not something I like, so he needs to stop doing it. Just like if I was doing something he didn't like, there's signs and signals that he gives that tells me that he doesn't like it, whether his ears go back or whatever it is. So it's just kind of like a mutual respect with each other and letting each other know with body language and tone. Is your family allowed to interact with Colt at home? Yes, my family is able to interact with my dog, but they ask first. They're respectful and they ask, and if he's off duty, then of course they can interact with him just like a normal dog. He'll be roaming the house, come back to check on me, whatever, when we're with family visiting and he's off duty. If he's on duty because I've been having a bad seizure day or, you know, I need him to help me get up and down or whatever it is, he'll be vested and he'll be laying next to me and patiently waiting for a chance to greet them. And I give him plenty of chances when we're with family because I love my family too and I want to spend time with them. So he deserves to have fun and play just as much as any other dog, and he gets plenty of time to do that, whether it's with family or not. How do you act towards another legitimate and fully trained service dog team in public? How do you want them to act towards you? Honestly, I've seen very few legitimate teams. It's very sad, but I would say 99% of the time they're a fake service dog team, as in someone bringing in their pet, or someone thinking that an emotional support animal has public access rights, and the dog either barks or growls or lunges or drags itself towards my dog or even is loose and runs up to Colt. He's been attacked multiple times, so I would say the majority of the time I do not see a legitimate team. But if I did, and I have very rarely, we've waved at each other before. We've just completely gone about our business before, where I was doing something and I didn't have time to, you know, do anything else. Like, I'm just trying to live my life. And just because I have a dog, a service dog as well, doesn't mean that, you know, it's like somebody's also in a wheelchair and someone else is in a wheelchair that they have to meet. So majority of the time, you just go about your life, maybe wave, maybe nod, maybe take a glance and appreciate that there's another real service dog team. Other than that, not much. The last experience with the legitimate service dog team was from Guide Dogs for the Blind. A visually impaired woman, very sweet, waited in line with us at a concert. Her dog was a little bit excitable, but that's understandable sometimes. Obviously, she corrected her dog, and the dog is a programmed dog, but dogs are not perfect. It was a little bit excitable, but it wasn't poorly behaved, and it didn't interfere with Colt. And Colt, you know, has been around so many dogs that he completely ignored it, but, you know, we stood right next to each other and kind of chatted a little bit, because we were waiting in line for a good hour or so before the concert. So most times though, just we go about our business, and you know, a legitimate team normally would just go about their business. Most teams only, you know, say something when the dog is interfering with their dog. Like, I'm not trying to be a rude person or a nitpicker or anything, but when a dog is barking at him trying to work or trying to come after him, especially if it's aggressive, believe me, I'm going to say something. Because he has been attacked multiple times, and this needs to stop. So, yeah. Other than that, if it's a real legitimate team, then we just go about our business. Do you have any online resources to help people learn about service dog laws? So many sites are incorrect and misleading. Absolutely. ADA.gov on service animals is your only legitimate information that you can get. There is also question and answers on that specific section of laws. Those two things are very legitimate, and they're the only thing really that you can go off of besides your personal state law on service animals. There are no other websites that are very accurate. Those laws, the state and federal laws, are what you need to look at. How do you train Colt to go potty on command? Detailed steps if you can. I'm not going to go into much detail because obviously this video is already going to have to be like a part one and part two. But for Colt being going potty on command, he is a service dog. He is a dog for a disabled person. And so I don't get out very often some days, and so he has one chance to go. And if he doesn't go, he's holding it. So that's kind of the way that I taught him, is I point in a certain area, go potty. If he goes potty, he gets praised. And when we come back inside, I normally do give him a treat because I find any reason to give him a treat. then if he doesn't go, then he comes back inside, and there's a possibility that it would be a few hours, and then maybe Garrett gets home and he's able to take him out and, you know, point in a certain area and say, go potty. If he goes, then he gets praised. If not, then he's got to hold it again. So he doesn't ever get to just walk around and dilly-dally unless we're out on a walk. He's going to play. He's off duty. When I bring him up to a spot and tell him to go to the bathroom, he goes to the bathroom right away where I point. I can even point at a specific tree and tell him to go potty and he'll lift his leg. And the reason that is so important for a service dog is because when you're going into a store, it is always good to empty the tank. Not that the dog is not trained and not gonna, you know, is gonna go in the store just because you didn't let him go to the bathroom. But, you know, a dog that helps you in your daily life, if it needs to go to the bathroom, take him to the bathroom. So before you go in a store, you don't know how long you're gonna be in there. Take him up to, you know, there's not very many places to go. So you take him up to those little medians and it has maybe a tree and a bunch of rocks. And if the dog is gonna be picky and want to wander the entire parking lot until you find a patch of grass to go to the bathroom, it's gonna cost you hours or an hour or whatever, and you just wanna go in and get something from the store. So the dog needs to just be reliable to be able to go to the bathroom. If it's raining, I mean, you're walking out getting drenched in the rain to try and get them to a grass spot to go to the bathroom, and then you wait 10 minutes for them to sniff around and find a spot. That's just not how it works. You bring them up to the tree, you say go to the bathroom, goes to the bathroom, you walk in the store and go about your business. You come back out, maybe the dog needs to go to the bathroom again. You go to the tree, say go to the bathroom, the dog empties again, and then you go to the car. Sometimes he'll just lift his leg, let a little bit out. You know, he may not empty all the way. I don't know, because, you know, if I come out of the store and I tell him to go again, he has a little bit more. I'm not going to sit out there and let him pee 16 times on every, you know, parking curb from here to Houston before I go into the store. So it's kind of like a respect thing again, where, you know, he needs to be there for me to work, and I'm respecting him and letting him go to the bathroom. So, how do you encourage a service dog to be in tune and protective without being high in separation anxiety or territorial? There we go. Has Cole ever been sick? What's something new we don't know about you? The first thing is a service dog's not allowed to be protective at all. It can be in tune with you, but it can't be protective. By law, it says that it cannot be protective. First of all, law wouldn't, protect you if you and the dog were a liability. So if the dog was protective or aggressive or any type of issue with the dog like that, it wouldn't be able to be a service dog. But you could help the dog be in tune with you, starting young with the dog, being around the dog as much as possible. Obviously you want to work in the times where you train for separation when it has to be a factor in your life. Maybe you're in the hospital or something. Normally you do not separate from a service dog, so it shouldn't be too much of an issue, but there are the few times, like I said, where I'm intubated in the hospital or something and Colt can't be there because I can't watch him. So you don't want to give him, you know, separation anxiety from never being apart from them. So you do want to train that for the few times that it may happen. Has Colt ever been sick? Yes, he has. Just the occasional stomach upset. I don't think anything else. Can't really. He's never really been like super sick or anything, but I've taken him to the vet for upset stomachs before just to make sure everything's okay. He gets checked every 6 months at the vet, so it's very, you know, common to be at the vet anyway. But if he hurts himself, which is very common, he's such a high drive dog and he's so like just barrels into things, like with no regard for how he just hurt himself. and doesn't even act like he hurt himself, like, ever. Like, he won't sit there and lick it or anything like another dog. I have to, like, examine his entire body to make sure he's okay because he's crazy. And he's, like, a red. It's classified as fox red. It's an actual color for labs. A lot of people only think that there's yellow, black, and brown chocolate. But, yeah, he's actually fox red, so it's really hard to see blood on him if he ever cuts himself or something. So he does go to the vet a lot more often than just 6 months, every 6 months, because he's getting, you know, his nail ripped up, and I have to go make sure that he doesn't get an infection and everything, just because he is a service dog. I'm not trying to, like, baby him and just go for no reason, but because he's a service dog, I always have to make sure he's cleared to work, make sure that it doesn't get worse, and hopefully that it heals to the best of its ability. What's something we don't know about you? Well, I don't know if there's much that you don't know about me, because I'm pretty open about everything. There may be a few things that I haven't mentioned from, like, my past. Most of my childhood is hard to remember because of my brain injury. I do have memories of it, but it's definitely not the way it should be, where I can just look back in the memory bank. But I did ride horses my whole life, English and Western. I did barrel racing and dressage and jumping and vaulting. Vaulting was my favorite. Horse vaulting is like gymnastics on horses. I think I shared this recently on Instagram. It's something that I loved a lot, but I always felt one with horses, and if I could physically do it again, I would. So maybe someday I could vault again, but I still do ride. Another question is, when did you get Colt? I think I said that already. I got him in 2013, about a year after my brain injury. What is Colt's favorite place to work? His favorite place to work, I would say, is the warehouse that my dad owns and I work out occasionally. I can't really keep a normal job because of my disability, but I do like to work when I can to feel like, you know, productive in society or whatever. And I like to help my dad, so whenever I can, I'm able to go help him, and that's his warehouse. And Colt loves helping there. He loves helping get boxes and breaking them down, and he's such a goof about it. He'll run around the entire warehouse to the trash can with this like huge box in his mouth, and he looks like a horse, like galloping around. So it's hilarious. What can the general public do to help service dog teams be respected, and how can we bring awareness to prevent the issue of fake service dogs? What is Colt's favorite task to do? Okay, so thank you so much for asking this question. It shows how much you care. Again, we just have such great people as subscribers and followers. You guys are all so great and so thoughtful. Thank you. But something you can do, whether you have a service dog or not, if you see a fake service dog, especially if you see a fake service dog barking or causing a disruption for a real service dog team, just go to the manager and say, you know, I have the laws, I can pull them up for you, but the laws state that you can ask these two questions, and that if the dog is being disruptive, whether they say it's a service dog or not, it can be asked to leave. And just to help educate, because I've been to so many places other than where I live now that is so much better with the fake service dog issue. Where I live now is just so bad. But I've been to other places, which, for an example, California is really great about it. There are some areas in California that are not so good with that ESA confusion. But majority of the places, you have cops and beach patrol coming up to you and asking you the real two questions. And I have only been asked that twice, like maybe three times in the entire time that I've had Colt in the state that I live in. That shows how little, like, obviously he looks legitimate and there's not really much of a reason for them to come up. But with how many times I've had people come up to me, only two or three times was I asked the appropriate questions instead of asked for fake proof, like an ID or certificate, or that if he's certified, and all that's fake. That's not even real. So, you know, just having somebody be so educated that they can state the laws and everything, it's just amazing. So props to Beach Patrol and police that I dealt with that know the laws. Thank you for what you do and that you educate yourself in your job enforcing the laws. And, you know, just if you can, please, if you care about service dog teams, if you care about us, please just help by going and educating yourself. Read ADA.gov on service animals. It's a page and a half. It's not long. And read your state laws on service animals. Most state laws are very plain and just say we follow the ADA laws. But just read them, know them, so that you can pull them up if you need to, so that you can recite them if you need to, and just speak up for us. Sometimes we can't speak up for ourselves. Especially if you see a fake service dog going after what looks to be a legitimate team. The dog is not being disruptive, but this dog is. Just please go to a manager, let them know that the law states if the dog's being disruptive, even if it says that it's a service dog, then they can still be asked to leave. Tell them what you saw. If a dog is not in a heel or, you know, physically tasking, like you're watching it, physically task something, being in a heel and completely focused on the handler, it's not a legitimate service dog. If the dog is out, away from the handler, smelling everything, off leash, smelling everything, you know, walking the person, which you see a lot here in America, that they don't train their dogs to be in a heel, and the dog is all over the place, the dog is barking, peeing, pooping, growling, anything like that, not a service dog. Please say something. That's the only way that these people are going to continue to get kicked out of establishments, because their dog is not a well-trained service dog. Even if the dog was, God forbid, a service dog in training, which gives a horrible name to service dogs in general, if your dog is not well behaved in a public place, even if it was, the handler would know that that is not acceptable behavior and would have left long ago or would have been trying to correct it. So you can always tell if it's a legitimate team or not, if the dog is legitimately in training and just needs a little reinforcement. But other than that, that kind of behavior is unacceptable even in service dog and training. They're not allowed to be in the store until they're completely obedience trained and not disruptive in any way. So please, please make sure that you say something, because you could be a voice for someone. You don't know if that dog is aggressive, and if that person doesn't get kicked out often, if people don't speak up against that person, then maybe that dog will attack someone like Colt someday. You know, a real service dog that's working and trying to do his job. And you just want to try and prevent that. So thank you for asking that question. What is Colt's favorite task to do? I would say retrieve my meds, because that was something that we really, really focused on, making sure that it's always going to be a perfect retrieve, that he's going to do that job 100% of the time, and high praise, so that it's a very fun thing for him to do, to search the whole house. No matter where it is, he'll find my meds for me. And I think that is his favorite, but he does also like picking up things for me. And some days that's a task, some days it's not. If I can pick something up on my own, he normally still does it, because he has an auto retrieve and it's something that he loves to do. But the days that I can't do it and it is considered a task, he does love picking things up, because that was one of the things that started as kind of a game to train him to do that. Did you have Colt before your TBI? No, I did not. I got him because of my TBI. I had no need for a service dog before that. Completely healthy, no health issues, nothing. When did you neuter him and why? Do you support intact service dogs working? Do you know the health reasons, benefits, and complications behind spaying and neutering? I didn't choose to neuter Colt. That was something that was done by the Weimaraner Rescue when all the dogs from the breeder had come in. So I didn't really have a choice in that, but honestly, I feel like he turned out great. If I could go back and undo that, I probably wouldn't with him particularly. Maybe with my next dog, I may make a different decision. And I am totally all for intact dogs working as long as they are appropriate. Obviously, sometimes intact dogs can cause, being intact can cause issues. And yes, I know all the health reasons, benefits, and complications. So that's why I'm thankful that Colt turned out the way he did, even though he was neutered. Since Colt alerts to seizures and syncope before they happen, are you allowed to drive without another person present? Yes, I am. I don't drive very often, though. As you can see in almost all of my videos, someone else is driving me, Garrett or a friend. But I do drive occasionally, but I always drive under 15 minutes round trip. And it's always on days where I'm not having seizures or any health issues and I can do it. And it's very rare. But I am only allowed to drive with Colt in the car. He is on my license. Like when the cop runs the license or whoever runs the license, which I've never had to get pulled over, which is wonderful. But it's on there just like if somebody has the, what is that called? Restriction for glasses. You can only drive with glasses. He's on that area of the license when they pull it up, and I would never drive without him anyway. And most of the times I choose not to drive, but I am legally allowed to drive with him. We've also been part of studies trying to figure out how service dogs are able to alert to seizures. And so he's proven to be able to alert even before medical equipment could. So that's another thing, is that he's, you know, proven to be able to alert. So that's how he's on my license. How long did it take to train Colt? Colt took about a year and a half to train, a little bit over a year and a half. Most service dogs take 2 to 3 years to train. He's just very high driven and he's a quick learner. But training never really stops with a service dog, but up until the point that he was considered like a service dog, no longer in service dog in training, that was, you know, he was probably about a year and a half more in his training. This says, what do you feed him? Favorite treats, toy, vet trips do you go in with him? What's your favorite food, color, PetSmart, Petco, Chewy, or BarkBox? Funniest moments with him? Biggest scare with him, proudest training moment. I feed him a raw diet, and if you're curious in that, latest video that I posted right before this is all about his raw diet. Favorite treats, I would say he loves homemade dehydrated pig ear pieces, and he loves homemade dehydrated duck feet, and he loves Nutro treats. They're not the healthiest thing, but since he eats such a healthy diet, I do allow him to have a few things that are not just a one ingredient thing, just because he is very active and very healthy. And I do love to give him treats and what he loves. He does love those treats. He always has. His favorite toy, I would say, even with the $30 toys that I buy, he still prefers a plain old stick. Vet trips, do I go in with him? Yes, I do. Always have. He goes to the vet quite often, every 6 months, but again, he hurts himself all the time, so we go in a lot. But I always want to make it a positive experience for him, because I know a lot of dogs develop like an issue with the vet, and he's never had that, so I want to always, you know, just reiterate to him like it's a great, fun place to be. He has no problems with the vet. They grab and pull on him and check his mouth and all that, and he doesn't care. My favorite food, is, I'd say sushi. Yeah, I'm a California girl for sure. And also, I love bow tie pasta with Alfredo. That is something special my dad used to make for us. He's such an amazing dad. But it brings back memories and I love it. So on special occasions, that is something that he used to make and now we do too on special occasions. My favorite color is lime green. It's always been that, but funny enough, traumatic brain injury awareness color is lime green. So that's my favorite. I love bright colors. I used to always love the neon colors. PetSmart or Petco, honestly, I don't mind between either. I think I go to PetSmart more just because it's closer to me, but I've gone to both and I think they're both fine. Chewy or BarkBox? I love Chewy and I love BarkBox for different reasons. Chewy, I go and order stuff all the time from, run out of something or whatever. It's a great source to be able to get many things. In BarkBox, I like a lot to have like a monthly surprise. It's really nice. Funniest moment with him, I would think, was like the day after I started teaching him to turn on and off the lights. Like, he wasn't even reliable in this task yet. And I was in the room folding laundry and he ran in and turned off the light on me and ran out. And I was like laughing so hard because, and he thought it was the funniest thing ever because he was like pranking me. It was hilarious. Like, how is a dog that smart? So that was hilarious. Like, he is a goofball for sure. Biggest scare with him, I would say every time he's attacked by a fake service dog or even just some pet that wasn't controlled properly, it's been really scary. I don't want him to get hurt, obviously, but then also is like the repercussions of that, you know, scared that he's going to develop PTSD or anxiety or an aggression towards dogs or something like that. And then what? You know, he would be washed from work, unable to work as my service dog. And then where would I be, you know, in life? So it's been really scary. You know, wondering how hurt he got, scared that he got hurt at all, feeling horrible that you couldn't do anything to protect him. And then the fear of repercussions afterwards. Proudest training moment. I would say just with how, you know, he's able to ignore things so well. I know like a lot of real legitimate service dogs that are not able to ignore things as well as he is. He's not perfect. There's times where he gets distracted too, but like his level, this is an example. We have a squirrel out here that is like best friends with Colt. I was wondering if he's going to react to that. Like best friends with him. And when Colt is working, Colt will ignore it 100%. Even when we're walking out to the car or whatever, he'll ignore this squirrel that runs up and like grabs him. He'll try and get his attention because they're friends. It's hilarious. And Colt will ignore it. And I just can't even, like, he ignores things so well. Like other dogs coming up and like lifting his hind end, they're trying to smell his area so intently that they're lifting him and Colt's ignoring it. So to me, that is just, I am so proud of him when he does that. Of course, he's not perfect, but man oh man, makes me proud. What type of mobility harness do I have? You're looking for a good brand of vest. I can hear some thunder outside. That's pretty cool. So the mobility harness that I have is a BLD, and honestly, it's extremely expensive. Mine with all the adaptions on it is about $800. So it's very expensive, but that thing has gone through some major beatings, man. I mean, it is well used and well loved and it barely shows it. It has helped me through so much. So if you need like bracing, counterbalance, and forward momentum, that is the way to go. it's expensive, but when you need something. So that's something that I love. I have all his vests basically have pull straps on them to help with forward momentum counterbalance, and my dog is tall enough for me to brace directly on him. Colt is pretty much able to help me mobility-wise in any of his gear. He has a ton of vests. What? Hi. He has a ton of vests with pull straps on them, which help with counterbalance and forward momentum, and he is big enough for me to brace directly on him. But that does change me in elevation a little bit, so there are days that I definitely need the BLD, the extra help on him. But pretty much in our situation, he helps mobility-wise in all of his harnesses. So it really just depends on you and your dog. Was Colt your first service dog? Yes, I didn't need a service dog before my brain injury at all, thank God. But I got him about a year after my brain injury. What brand of vest does Colt wear? He wears many brands. I do love Rough Wear. A lot of his, you know, vests are Rough Wear with the big pockets, his boots and stuff like that. They're very durable, but I have many other brands that are very helpful as well. So I don't really have a specific brand. We use many different brands. Last question for this one, for part one. I'm going to do a part two video, so keep an eye out for that. Do you have any training tips for a young German Shepherd? German Shepherds are a very particular breed. It takes a lot of experience to train them and work with them. I've worked with them my whole life. Definitely, if you don't have experience with the German Shepherd breed specifically, please go find somebody to help you that does have specific training with German Shepherd dogs, have done it before, because that type of dog, there's other breeds too that need specific care, but a German Shepherd is very high driven, and if you do certain things wrong, you're going to live with it. If you do, you know, if you allow the dog to do these things, then you're going to live with it. There's just certain things that you have to work with in certain ways with German Shepherds. So if you don't have experience in the breed, please don't try to do it yourself. Owning and training a dog is a responsibility, and that includes sometimes paying a lot of money for, you know, training. So I hope that helps you guys. I answered all your questions. I sometimes go a little bit in depth. I hope that you enjoyed that instead of it being annoying. I'm sorry that this video is so long. There's gonna be a part two. That was all the questions from YouTube. I will do a part two with all the questions from Instagram. Thank you guys so much for asking these wonderful questions and for caring so much to ask all these questions. I enjoy talking to you guys. I enjoy answering your questions. Sometimes it's really hard for me to have the energy. I may be getting alerted here. He was over here and then he went over here. So we'll see. So I'm going to go. But thank you guys so much for all that you do, asking questions and caring about that. But sometimes I just can't answer them all because I get the same questions a lot and I try to answer them, but sometimes I just don't have the energy. But thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video. Keep an eye out for the part two, and I will talk to you guys later.